Good morning, everybody. 128,000 tests done to 8pm yesterday. Another bumper day. Thank you for everybody who's come forward to get tested. We had, unfortunately, 390 cases of community transmission. Some are still under investigation, but at least 60 of those have been infectious in the community. And I anticipate, given the large number of cases we've had in the last few days, that unfortunately this trend will continue for at least the next few days. So it means all of us have to work harder to make sure we stay at home and follow the rules. Tragically, two people lost their lives overnight because of COVID. One woman in her 40s in southwestern Sydney who died at home tragically. She wasn't vaccinated, and we extend our heartfelt condolences to her loved ones and extended family. There was also the tragic death of a man in his late 90s in the Hunter, New England area. He was vaccinated but also under palliative care. Again, our heartfelt sympathies and condolences. I know that every day when we read the statistics about the deaths, we often remember or don't remember that behind every single statistic is a loved one, a family, and many carers. So we extend our heartfelt thoughts to all of them. The main challenges remain Western Sydney and southwestern Sydney. And whilst, again, we've seen an ongoing stabilisation in Fairfield and Canterbury-Bankstown still has the highest number of cases, but we have seen stabilisation and the cases aren't growing the way they were in the last few weeks, which is a positive. But the health experts have asked me to highlight Blacktown and Mount Druitt as areas of concern and adjoining areas. So we're really wanting to make sure that people living in Blacktown and Mount Druitt and those adjoining suburbs come forward for testing, stay home, and if they haven't already got vaccinated and they don't have symptoms, to come forward and get vaccinated. Unfortunately, also around the Dubbo region, Dubbo in Western New South Wales is becoming a big challenge health-wise with 25 cases overnight. And of course, the New South Wales government has been liaising with our federal colleagues as well to make sure we get support to those communities in Western New South Wales and far Western New South Wales. And anything we may need to do further in that area is being considered during the day today. Hunter, New England had 5 additional cases, which is an improvement of the last few days. However, pleasingly, Tamworth, Armidale and Northern Rivers had no cases, which is pleasing. However, obviously, we're not out of the woods in those areas, given there were those exposure sites. In relation to vaccines, thank you to the 105,000 people who got jabbed yesterday. That's an outstanding result. Pleasingly, by the end of today, 15,000 HSE students would have received the jab. So, again, a very pleasing result. In 5 days, we've done 15,000 HSE students. And I want to thank them all for coming forward and getting the jab. It means they can sit safely for their examinations later in the year. This Sunday, we have a bumper day of vaccinations for tradies and construction workers. There's already around 10,000 people who've booked throughout those locations, and I just want to stress that the one location in Prairiewood will maintain its status as a walk-in centre. So if you're a tradie or a construction worker, you haven't already got a jab and you haven't booked anywhere or won't be booking by that day, you can walk into the Prairiewood Centre and get the jab as well. And that's pleasing that the construction sector and tradies have been very enthusiastic about coming forward and getting the jab, and certainly getting back to work safely has been an incentive for that group of workers. Pleasingly, from Monday next week, 100,000 authorised workers aged between 16 and 39 years of age in those local area governments of concern in Greater Sydney will be getting a jab. So through their workplaces and through other points of contact, they'll be sent invitations. So over and above what we're doing already, 100,000 authorised workers. And we know that workplaces and households remain and continue to be the greatest source of infection. We know there's categories of workers that just can't stay at home because of the important work they do, whether it's in healthcare, whether it's in getting food on our table. They must work, and knowing that they're going to get vaccinated gives us that greater degree of confidence in trying to reduce the spread, but also in making sure people stay out of hospital. And that's what we need to ensure. Please know that by following the rules and getting vaccinated, You are making sure that you keep yourself and your loved ones safe, and it's really, really important that if you haven't had the vaccine, please consider getting it to make sure that you stay safe, you stay out of hospital, but also that we do everything we can to reduce the spread. I also wanted to highlight to the community, given National Cabinet's meeting today, that according to the Doherty report, which the New South Wales government supports, once you get to 70% double doses, it triggers certain conditions. And of course, once you get to 80% of your adult population on double doses, that means obviously that communities start to live with COVID in a real and meaningful way. So on current projections, conservatively, New South Wales will get to 70% double doses by the end of October. And by mid-November, we hope to get to 80% double doses. And of course, I'm looking forward to those 6 million jabs occurring by the end of August. And so far, we're doing very well. I think we're up to 4.7 million or 4.8 million by the end of today in terms of jabs. Hopefully, we'll get to 5 million early next week, and then the sprint towards 6 million by the end of August. And we're looking forward to hitting those milestones, because we know the more of us, the higher percentage of us that are vaccinated, the greater opportunities we have in the future and the greater opportunities we have to live more freely and safely. I'll now ask Dr. Marianne Gale to give the health update. Deputy Commissioner Willing will talk about some police operations, and then we'll take some questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Premier, and good morning, everyone. There were 390 locally acquired cases of COVID-19 reported in New South Wales to 8 p.m. last night, and one overseas case. There were almost 130,000 tests reported to 8 p.m. last night. So again, a big thank you to all the community for coming out to get tested. And again, an all-important reminder that even with the mildest of symptoms, we ask you to please come forward to get tested and continue to do so in the great numbers that you are. In terms of COVID-19 cases in hospital, there are currently 391 cases admitted to hospital. 63 cases are in intensive care and 30 require ventilation. Of the 63 in ICU, 4 are in their 20s, 6 are in their 30s, 5 in their 40s, and 15 are in their 50s. And I just want to emphasise, I guess, again to people the importance, particularly for young people in our community. With this Delta variant, we are seeing a large number of younger adults being affected by COVID-19. In the last 14 days, that 20 to 29-year-old age group we have seen being the biggest numbers. And so I just want to particularly encourage younger adults in our community to please take the stay-at-home orders in the Greater Sydney area, as seriously as you possibly can. Please follow the advice. Please get tested. Please get vaccinated. Of the 63 people who are in ICU, 55 are not vaccinated. As the Premier mentioned, we're very sad to be notified that 2 cases of COVID died overnight. The first is a man in his late 90s from Newcastle who died at Hawkins Masonic Village in Edgeworth. He had acquired his infection recently as part of the outbreak in the facility. He had received 2 doses of vaccine, and our heartfelt sympathies go out to that family at this time. The second death notified was a woman in her 40s who died at home in southwestern Sydney. She was a close contact of another confirmed case. She tested positive on August 7th and was unvaccinated. And the local health district will be investigating her death and also be referring it to the coroner. And again, our sincere, heartfelt condolences to her family. I'd like to provide a brief update on Western New South Wales. Overnight, we had 10 new cases identified in the Western New South Wales local health district, the majority being in Dubbo and two in Walgett. It is an evolving situation in Western New South Wales that we are carefully monitoring, and we do expect to see some further cases emerge. In the sewage detection, there has been COVID-19 detected in the Bathurst region, Parkes and Bourke. And so we encourage all the community in Western New South Wales to please note the stay-at-home orders, stay within your household, don't go out only for reasonable excuses. Please seek testing and please get vaccinated as soon as you have an opportunity to do so. In Hunter, New England, there were five cases notified overnight. One is an additional case associated with the residential aged care facility, and the four other cases are those linked to previously reported cases. And finally, just to emphasise, as the Premier did earlier, we'd like to encourage people who live in the Blacktown area and Mount Druitt area as well to please follow the stay-at-home order and please come forward for testing if you have even the mildest of symptoms. Thank you.
Good morning, Premier, Minister. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. In the last 24 hours, 404 infringement notices have been issued and 41 people charged with breaches of the public health order. It's simply unbelievable at this point in the current crisis that people are still flouting the rules. I can indicate that, as you're aware, yesterday a 19-year-old Rose Bay man was charged with breaching the public health order by travelling to the Byron Bay area. A 52-year-old man remains before the courts in relation to the same matters. I can indicate this morning that overnight a 21-year-old female and a 20-year-old female were charged with breaching the public health orders by travelling to the Newcastle area around 2 weeks ago. Police will be alleging that both of those women have a history of non-compliance with the public health orders. And I've got to say that people travelling to regional areas from Greater Sydney are putting regional communities at risk. If we don't catch you during our compliance operations, which is highly likely given the amount of resources that are out there on our roads and in our communities trying to find people in breach of public health orders, we will do so through our investigations. Just overnight, police responded to 1,100 odd Crime Stoppers reports. All of those spark investigations. Now, in saying that, I'd like to thank the people who are abiding by the current health orders. In the last 24 hours alone, police have conducted over 1,800 welfare compliance checks, checking on over 3,000 people. And the advice that I've received this morning is that all of those people were in compliance with the public health orders. So thank you to those people. And I just want to reiterate too that emergency management arrangements in the form of local emergency management committees and regional emergency management committees are up and running across the state of New South Wales to support people through this difficult period. In regional New South Wales, particularly in the far west of the state, those arrangements include specific action plans that have been developed with input from local communities and tailored to local communities out there to help them through this current difficult period. So thank you very much.
Dr. Gale. Oh, sorry. Yeah. Can we just clarify the numbers? So the Premier said 25. And so can you just run through that quickly?
That's right. Yeah. So the numbers I was giving was till 8 p.m. last night. The Premier's right, and hence I mentioned it is an evolving situation in the district. We are seeing some further cases come through. So yes, there will be. There's around 22 cases currently in Western New South Wales, but the figures I gave were to 8 p.m. last night.
That's obviously incredibly concerning, that level of transmission in that area.
That's right. And so we are concerned about Western New South Wales and why we're asking residents of Western New South Wales and those LGAs that have been named as where stay-at-home orders are in place to really follow the public health advice. Do stay home, don't have visitors to your household, only leave your household if you have a reasonable excuse, and please come forward for testing if you have the mildest of symptoms. So there are considerable efforts going on locally from New South Wales Health and partners, including the federal government, to support the response in Western New South Wales. We're particularly aware that we see a large proportion of the population in that part of New South Wales being Aboriginal communities, and we're particularly conscious of being able to best support our Aboriginal communities during this time.
Doctor, how many of those cases are in Indigenous communities?
Look, I'm not going to provide the overall breakdown, but certainly some of the cases are Aboriginal people, and we're conscious that in those in that part of the state, many of our Aboriginal communities often come from large families, do move around as part of, you know, cultural practice, and so hence our advice for that area to please follow the health advice, stay home, stay within your household. Only leave if you have a reasonable excuse. And as I said, operationally, we're putting many supports in place to best support our Aboriginal community in particular during this time. Thank you.
We're at the end of week 7 of lockdown. Record number of cases today. Crisis Cabinet's going to consider and be asked to bring in more restrictions and tighten the health orders. Why has that taken so long?
Look, it's really important that we're dealing with a strain of COVID, the Delta variant, which is really untested in this magnitude in Australia. And we need to make sure we're flexible and adapt as the disease and the virus moves through our communities. And we have learned a lot in the last few weeks. And I think it's important, as I've said from day one, that if there are evolving situations, if there are updates to the health advice, we need to take that on board. We need to make sure we consider it.
Not health advice.
Yeah, in relation to the police advice, as I said, the police commissioner and the deputy commissioners, Deputy Commissioner Warboys, Deputy Commissioner Willing, have been on the ground, and can I thank them for setting up the emergency management committees in those local government areas of concern, including in Western New South Wales. The police have been outstanding throughout this process in making sure they're standing up a whole of government response whenever there's a local government area of concern, whether it's in Greater Sydney or whether it's in our regions. And this means bringing together and wrapping around whole of government services, whether it's compliance activity, whether it's obviously the health services, but also social services in some very challenging communities in part. So it's really important to make sure those processes, those extra compliance measures continue. And if there's more we need to do, we'll be considering advice from police in relation to additional measures as well.
Your target for next month, easing restrictions in areas...
I'm sorry, I didn't hear the question.
Sorry, your target for next month, easing restrictions in area with high vax rates and low case numbers, that's mainly going to benefit Sydney's richer, older suburbs, including yours, I think. So how does it sit with you that, you know, Sydney's poorer people are not going to be able to enjoy the same freedoms that, you know, the richer citizens will be able to?
Please know that we're pouring so many additional resources into those communities that are experiencing the higher case numbers. It was very pleasing to me that HSC students were offered vaccines this week, 15,000 of them. 100,000 16 to 39-year-olds will be offered vaccine in those local government areas of concern from Monday next week, an opportunity I know that many other people would like in that age group to get the vaccine. And, of course, we're also making sure that we have the additional pop-up clinics, the additional social services. So please know we're doing everything we can to support communities going through that difficult time. But we do also know that we're all connected. We do also know that when one part of our great state is going through a particularly difficult time, it impacts on all of us. And we can't afford setbacks, but we also can't afford to leave communities behind. Quite the contrary. We're working very hard to make sure we put resources in those areas that are needed. And that's why those extra 100,000 vaccines to authorise workers gives me a degree of comfort, because it's very targeted. It's targeted to those young people that are still having to move around from those communities because of their jobs, and it goes specifically to workplaces. And I want to thank various industry leads, industry heads who've worked with us to target those categories of workers who will be getting the 100,000 jabs, the young ones, the 16 to 39-year-olds, who we know in this outbreak are as susceptible to Delta, but also, unfortunately, because of their jobs, are then potentially taking that home to their large extended families. And if we get to them next week, we think that will have a positive impact in reducing the spread, but also importantly, and again, I know it's horrible every time you talk about a death, But that is what we need to prevent. We need to prevent people ending up in hospital, and we need to prevent people dying. And that's why vaccines will help. Stopping the spread obviously helps. But I'm not going to shy away from the fact that increasing case numbers is a horrible situation and not one we want to be in. But please be reassured that our absolute commitment is to reduce those case numbers whilst we're increasing the vaccination rate. Clinton was next. Clinton. Sorry, excuse me. Can you just wait your turn?
Regarding Canberra, but the regions as well, given the close proximity to the South Coast, Queanbeyan, those areas, are you looking to put those areas in lockdown?
Well, look, it is an evolving situation, so we'll look at the health advice. And I know that people are concerned about various movements that have occurred overnight from the ACT to parts of our South Coast, and we have had concerns from community leaders about that today. So the health team has advised the Minister and myself that they're looking at those issues today. It's an evolving situation, and if we need to do anything as a preemptive move, we will, similar to what we've done in other parts of the state, we will. But no doubt, what is really critical is in a pandemic, you can't just say this is what we're doing today and just stand still. When things change, when things move very quickly, you have to adapt and move as well, and that's exactly what we're doing.
Thank you so much. With the evolving health orders and the police enforcement, which seems to be increasing, there's still confusion around some of the public health orders. For instance, on the Health Service New South Wales website, it says people can leave those red zone LGAs if they're engaged with looking after vulnerable people. Now, with that, when you call Service New South Wales, they say that they couldn't tell you whether it's a family member who's allowed to go, and they say it's up to the police officer at the time to enforce the rules. How are people meant to know whether they're breaking the rules and whether they could be subject to a fine?
Look, it's pretty obvious to us and pretty obvious from the feedback we get from police that people use the health orders as an excuse or to do the wrong thing. So people are saying, oh, I didn't know this was this or this was that. Most of the time, that's not true. Most of the time, people are knowingly. Can I make this very clear? Police are doing an incredible job in terms of compliance, but let's not pretend that people are doing the right thing. People are knowingly doing the wrong thing and pretending it's because they didn't understand. Now, we've been very clear about what the rules are. Stay at home unless you absolutely have to leave your house because of authorised work. And make sure if you have symptoms, you don't leave the house, you get tested and stay home and isolate. And of course, come forward and get vaccinated. People know the basic rules. Unfortunately, again, can I acknowledge, and this is really important, because if you go to some of those local government areas of concern in Western Sydney and southwestern Sydney, I get updates from Deputy Commissioner Warboys and Willing all the time. Some streets are absolutely bare. There is nobody around. The vast majority of people are doing the right thing. But when a handful don't, it is a setback for all of us. For example, there was one person who knowingly did the wrong thing and has caused havoc in about 7 or 8 local government areas in Western New South Wales. Now, this just demonstrates Delta does not leave any room for error. Delta does not leave any room for even 1 or 2 people doing the wrong thing. I want to stress that the vast majority of people are really trying to do everything as best they can, but it's a handful that use the health orders as an excuse when in fact they know they're doing the wrong thing. And I don't know if Deputy Commissioner Willing has an update on that situation in Byron Bay, for example. When people knowingly do the wrong thing and pretend they didn't know, that's not acceptable. So I'm a bit tired of hearing people saying they don't know what they're supposed to do. It's really people knowingly having disregard, unfortunately, for their loved ones and also the rest of us in breaching the health orders. Sorry, we'll just get it. So we'll just give everybody a turn. Yep.
Details about the number of ICU beds in Western New South Wales, number of ventilators, and also are the federal government sending in field hospitals or extra help from the ADF?
I might ask Health Minister Hazard to comment on that, but I can say at the outset that we've been advised extra Pfizer jabs will be arriving to Western New South Wales, and I might ask Dr. Hazard, as he's been in touch with his counterparts.
Thanks, Anne. Look, obviously there is a big challenge in northwestern New South Wales because the townships and towns that we're talking about are principally places, for example, like Walgett. Walgett probably has about 3,500 people generally in town, But in the broad area, there'd be about maybe 6,000. And obviously, the medical facilities are much smaller than you'd expect to find in a major city like Sydney. There's an Aboriginal medical service there which does excellent work, very large building and a reasonable number of staff, but they manage in normal times, but trying to manage if there is a major outbreak of something that is a 1 in 100-year virus is certainly going to be a challenge for them. So the night before last, I wrote to Minister Hunt and just pointed out that the Aboriginal community, of course, I should go back one step and just say that in Walgett, the Aboriginal community probably makes up about 80% of the community, give or take. And I pointed out to him on behalf of the state government that we would need them to step in and do the work that they said they would be doing much earlier, and that is to try and vaccinate as many people as possible and provide support. I want to acknowledge that the federal government has been under massive pressure because of the desire to get as much vaccine into the country as possible, but the whole world is chasing vaccine. But they have stepped up. Minister Hunt responded quite quickly. I think it was within an hour or two. He responded to me and indicated that they would have the appropriate committees put in place to get the ADF working with the public health network up there and with the Western New South Wales local health district. At this stage, they've offered, in fact, may have already delivered by now. I haven't managed to update this morning, but they were getting vaccines up there as quickly as possible. They were getting about 8,000 vaccines to add to the vaccines that New South Wales was already sending up to Walgett. But is it a serious issue for the local community? Yes, it is, very much so, because the ICU in a place like that is nowhere near what we would expect in Sydney. So that's why the entire New South Wales Health Service is on high alert and is asking the community up there to definitely stay at home. Obviously, in the broader community, there's a more likely circumstance would be to see family members moving between households. Our big effort this morning is to try and get that message through to locals that stick just in your own household right at the moment. Some of the households are quite large households, which presents issues because you might have one person go in, but there could be 10 or 12 people living in that household, and you could instantly have 10 or 12 more people positive. So we're doing what we can. As I speak, I know that the committees are meeting with the federal government, our state committees and the incident committees that that Deputy Commissioner Willing talked about earlier, to try and work out what staff might be available on the ground. At this point, I can't give you a clear indication of what federal staff would be available, but they're also under pressure. So I would just say this, that the basic message to the community is this is one that the community really do have to take some responsibility and make sure you stay at home, listen to the messages, don't go out unless you absolutely crucially have to for the vital reasons that are well known now. So only if you can't work from home, or only if you need to go out for health reasons, essentially, and limited amounts of exercise if you can do that, and stick to only one other person if you go out in terms of a walk, but basically stay at home.
How many ventilators are there in Dubbo?
Could I go to Lucy first? Sorry.
Are the vaccination rates in the Indigenous community good enough this far into the pandemic?
I'm sorry, Lucy, say that again.
The vaccination rates of the Indigenous community in this area, is that good enough this far into the pandemic?
And when you say good enough, it's a loaded question in the sense of are we seeking to blame somebody? I'll just say this, that there's a shortage of vaccines across the world, and until the last few weeks there's been, I mean, every day I come here and every day when I arrive at the office there's texts and emails asking for vaccines to go to different sections of the community, and they sometimes would prefer one vaccine over another. I think there's been a challenge that is obvious to everybody, we would have all liked far more vaccine to have been in those more remote communities, because it was identified last year that there were some risks in our state, particularly in those areas. In other states, I've spoken to the health ministers there, they have had the same issues. So I think it's not a case of blaming anybody, just recognising that there have been other priorities, and now the federal government are obviously trying to assist us, or we're trying to assist them, I should say, in a sense of doing what was their obligation, and that is making sure, hang on, making sure that we try and get those vaccines up there and into arms.